The final part to the history of classic musicals will feature some of the most popular and beloved musicals of all time. It will also show how the public's tastes were changing by the end of the Golden Age. As with every video, please be sure to like, share, and subscribe. Also, please join the show's Patreon page to support what we do. This has been a fun journey thus far, and I'm excited to share with all of you some of the best musicals in cinema history. Without further ado, I'm Big Rob, and this is part 3 of our history of classic musicals. Enjoy. The peak of Golden Age musicals occurred during the 1950s, a time when most of the public were purchasing television sets. Television caused theater attendance to fall by half, forcing the studios to find new ways to bring audiences back. MGM was still considered the best at making musicals, and this showed in one of the most ambitious musicals of all time, An American in Paris. This film was produced by Arthur Freed and starred Gene Kelly and newcomer Leslie Caron. An American in Paris was ambitious because of how Freed and Kelly wanted to end the film, which was with a 20-minute dance number. Irving Berlin, who was a veteran composer and lyricist, visited MGM while the sets for the film were being made, and spoke with Arthur Freed and Gene Kelly. When they told him their idea, he was understandably surprised and wished them luck. The film turned out to be a huge success, garnering 8 Academy Award nominations, winning 6. While I don't have time to show the entire ending, I would like to show one of my favorite scenes, which features a musical number called I Got Rhythm, where Gene Kelly does a performance for the local children. Enjoy.
Hello, maintenant, une chanson américaine. An American song. Dis-moi. I got.
I got.
Bon. I got.
I got.
I got.
I got.
Tous ensemble.
I got.
Bon. Mais toujours la même chose. I got.
I got.
Rhythm.
I got.
Music.
I got.
My gal, who could ask for anything more? Daisy,
I got.
In green pastures,
I got.
My gal, who could ask for anything more? Old man trouble, I don't mind him. You won't find him round my door.
Vous comprenez ça?
Non. I got.
Rhythm,
I got.
Music,
I got.
My gal, who could ask for anything more? Who could ask for anything more?
La même chose en français.
J'ai du rythme, j'ai de la musique. J'ai ma chérie, who could ask for anything more? J'ai des daisies dans green pastures. J'ai ma chérie, who could ask for anything more? Old man trouble, I won't find him. You won't find him hanging round my door.
Comprenez ça maintenant?
No!
I got!
Yeah!
I got!
Yeah!
I got!
I got!
Who could ask for anything more?
Who could ask for anything more?
I found some etiquette!
Le time step.
Le time step.
Ah oui, le time step. C'est le shim sham.
Le shim sham.
Ah. Charleston.
Charleston.
Je ne sais pas.
Cowboy!
Cowboy!
An American in Paris was released in 1951, and as stated before, was very ambitious. The next year, however, MGM would release what is now one of the most beloved musicals in all of cinema history. That film is Singin' in the Rain, a lighthearted look into Hollywood's conversion from silent to sound film. Arthur Freed once again produces, while Gene Kelly shows his directing chops alongside longtime collaborator and co-director Stanley Donen. As with An American in Paris, Singin' in the Rain features a newcomer female lead, Debbie Reynolds. Reynolds found the production of the film to be one of the hardest experiences of her life. At one point, she was sitting under a piano crying when a pair of legs walked by and helped her up to comfort her. That person turned out to be Fred Astaire. When she explained why she was so sad, Astaire explained that learning how to dance was one of the hardest things a person can do, but it was important to keep working hard at it. He then did something unheard of at the time. Fred Astaire allowed Debbie Reynolds to watch him practice. Fred Astaire was notorious for not allowing anyone to watch him rehearse. He would rehearse with a drummer and a guard at the door. Watching him go through his steps and how angry he would get when something didn't go right, Reynolds saw that even the best must struggle to make dancing look perfect. This experience inspired her to perform better, and Singin' in the Rain became another massive success for the studio. With so many great musical numbers in this film, I think it's best if I share the most famous number, where Gene Kelly sings Singin' in the Rain. Before I show it, however, I just want to point out that this song was first written by Arthur Freed in 1929 for MGM's film, The Hollywood Review of 1929. Anyway, enjoy this wonderful number.
Singing in the rain, what a glorious feel, and I'm happy again. I'm laughing at clouds so dark up above. The sun's in my heart, and I'm ready for love. Let the stormy clouds chase everyone from the place. Come on with the rain, I've a smile on my face. I walk down the lane with a happy refrain. Just singing, singing in the rain. Dancing in the rain. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Singing and dancing in the rain. singing in the rain.
I want to point out other musicals that were successful during the 1950s. One of them featured Marilyn Monroe in the film Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, directed by Howard Hawks. Hawks had made a name for himself in virtually every genre of film. Musicals came about later in his career, starting with the 1948 film A Song Is Born. His Marilyn Monroe-led film features a classic song whose title is still used as a form of expression today, Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend.
Kiss on the hand may be quite continental, but diamonds are a girl's best friend. A kiss may be grand, but it won't pay the rental on your humble flat or help you at the automat. Men grow cold as girls grow old, and we all lose our charms in the end. Square cut or pear shape, these rocks don't lose their shape. Diamonds are a girl's best friend. Tiffany's.
But get that ice or else no dice. He's your guy when stocks are high, but beware when they start to descend. It's then that those louses go back to their spouses. Diamonds are a girl's best friend.
confess that you must keep a sonic a bet of bets. If little pets get big baguettes, time rolls on and youth is gone, and you can't straighten up when you bend. But stiff back or stiff knees, you stand straight and
another musical that is not mentioned much is the classic Carmen Jones, which features two African-American leads directed by Otto Preminger. The two leads were Dorothy Dandridge and Harry Belafonte, who showed wonderful chemistry on screen. Dandridge herself gave an amazing performance, one of the highlights being her musical number, That's Love. Her performance was so well received that she became the first African-American woman nominated for the Academy Award for Best Actress. Judy Garland, during the 1950s, had hit a fork in the road in her career. She had been let go from MGM at this time and was trying to work through her personal issues. Her big comeback came with the Warner Brothers classic, A Star Is Born, released in 1954. In a way, the film itself highlights Judy's own struggles, as her character suffers from the negative aspects of fame. However, the film was incredibly successful and even garnered Judy an Academy Award nomination for Best Actress. This proved that Judy Garland could still put out amazing performances even with a different studio. Elvis Presley would also make a huge impression during the 1950s, as he quickly became the biggest music act in the world. His foray into films produced not only one of his most famous songs, but arguably his greatest film, Jailhouse Rock. Elvis was a lot like Marlon Brando and James Dean, as all three men personified the rebelliousness of the youth during that time period. Elvis, however, went a step further with his unique dancing and deep singing voice. What's interesting to note about this film is that it was shot in black and white. By the 1950s, most films, especially musicals, were shot in Technicolor. By the end of the decade, the Golden Age was all but finished. The 1960s may have produced some classic musicals, but at the time of their release, they did not do well at all. These films include Camelot, Hello Dolly, Dr. Doolittle, and a musical remake of Goodbye, Mr. Chips. There were successes, however. For example, West Side Story, My Fair Lady, Mary Poppins, and The Sound of Music. But musicals in the classic sense mostly ended during the 1950s. Before I end this video, I want to leave you all with one of my favorite dance numbers from one of my favorite musicals, Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. This film, directed by Stanley Donen, starring Jane Powell and Howard Keel, was shot in CinemaScope. CinemaScope provided a new widescreen format that brought audiences back to the theaters. Musicals utilized this to great success, and what you're about to see is one of their many achievements. The number features dancers from the New York City Ballet, showing some of the best choreography ever put to film. Enjoy.
Come on, everybody, get your partners. There's going to be dancing. We'll be right back.
Enjoyed the final part of our look into classic musicals. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe, and support the show's Patreon page to help us put out more videos like these. Thank you all again for watching, and Joe and I will see you all again soon.